Let me get this out of the way. Is this film perfect? No. Is it really a 10 out of 10 movie for me? Probably not. But if I can stand up on my soapbox for a second, I think everybody has a movie that they love way more than they probably should. For some people, it's Batman vs. Superman. For others, it's one of the Star Wars prequels. But for me, it's Eternals. It's this stupid, self-absorbed, overly long and complicated Marvel film that did way more for me than I ever anticipated. I've seen this film 5 times now, which is insane because I don't think I've ever seen a movie this many times in recent memory, but every time I see it, I get something new out of it. So why not sit back and let me tell you why Marvel's first critical flop might just be my favorite film in the franchise. To make this video easier on myself and you as a viewer, I think I'm going to split it up into chapters. The first one will be talking about the film's greatest strength, its characters, while chapter 2 is focused on the concepts and themes of the film, and 3 will be focused on the creativity and filmmaking aspects of it. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into the characters. I really love the characters in Eternals. Even characters that I wasn't so hot on my first watch just get more likable every time I watch it. Take a character like Sprite. I really didn't care much for her on the first time that I watched the movie. But every time I've seen it afterward, I've gotten more invested in her personal struggles, whether it's her love for Icarus or the fact that she wants so badly just to have what other humans can have and what the other Eternals can have from humans. I think it's really, really interesting, and I really love the direction they end up going with the character. There's still some moments where I feel like she can be a little bit annoying, but I do really like this character at the end of the day. I also often read so many comments and reviews about how Cersei lacks a character, but for me, she doesn't at all. Her character is that she's the most human of the group. She stands apart from everyone, not because she's dull, but because she's just a quiet and more introspective person. There are several scenes where everyone else around her is joking and having fun, and she sits idly by, smiling and just simply enjoying their company. She doesn't have much dialogue, but you can tell she's part of them all the same. I think great examples of this come in the form of the Bollywood scene, where Kingo is introduced in the present. Icarus and Sprite look on at the humans with pure apathy, they're just not really interested. Meanwhile, Cersei will stand there admiring it with wonder in her eyes. It's a subtle little moment, but it's one that I really, really love. Her character is just more introverted, and it's very interesting to see how humans have impacted her in that way. Druig is another character who I never really appreciated until this watch, but I really love him now. I love how angry he is, how violent and disgusting he finds humanity. It's really interesting since most of the other characters seem to carry this joy for humanity, and yet despite finding humans to be destructive creatures, you can tell he still cares about them by the end. A discussion with Cersei following Gilgamesh's death confirms this when Druig reveals that humans just aren't humans without their deadly vices, and he didn't have it in himself to take control of all of humanity. Icarus is a character who benefits greatly from seeing the film at least a second time. Once you know the big twist that he, you know, killed Ajax and is hiding so much, the performance from Richard Madden is amazing. The way he hides himself from everyone else and all the lies is just something that I really adore, and I used to think that Madden was a weaker link amongst the cast, but now I think he's one of the best people in it. I'll talk more about him later, specifically in how he relates to the themes about loyalty and faith in this movie, but he's such a damn good character and just might be my new favorite Eternal. Kingo gives us perhaps one of the most interesting looks at how an Eternal cares about humanity. This guy really, really loves humanity, but he loves them in a different way than everybody else. You know, he really loves movies and storytelling, these things invented by humanity, and I find that really, really cool. I also love how he has this new moral look at how the Emergence should be handled. It's not out of loyalty to Ereshkigal like Icarus, but it's a sense of morality, and that's one of the most interesting parts about him. He brings up letting Tiamat be born as the right thing after Gilgamesh calls the Eternal the villains, and it makes me wonder if Kingo even truly believes that this is a moral right, or if he's trying to convince himself of it. His entire existence has been a lie, and the humanity he cares deeply for is a means to an end. I just find them to be a very interesting character, beyond all the really funny jokes that he does get. Fastos's character is tied to humanity primarily in their advancement of them. He adores the way humans learn and grow, and he helps them along the way. However, I feel like that eventually leads to a breaking point once he sees the tragedy of Hiroshima. It really causes Fastos to wonder if humanity is worth the effort, which leads into the themes that the film will bring up later. It's a strong and powerful moment for someone who was so focused and excited about helping humans to regret everything he's done for them, and I think it's made all the more richer when he's the one character to settle down with a family. Thena and Gilgamesh share a beautiful story where one of them gives their entire life to help the other. Gilgamesh could do so much more as an Eternal, but resides in the Outback with Thena, helping her and nursing her back to health anytime her mind becomes too much for her. And Gilgamesh's tragic end in the film is just another time he's put everything in the background for the sole purpose of helping Thena. I feel like if there was ever an emotional core to this film, it's gotta be these two. They're more interesting to me than Cersei and Icarus, and they're more developed and fleshed out than Makari and Druig. That being said, I do still really like Makari and Druig, and I feel like it's one of the things that make Makari's character really work for me. Her and Ajak don't get much, but I came away from this time enjoying them more still. Ajak is still the closest character to actually get nothing, but I still find a bit more of her interesting when you realize that she kept it a secret from the Eternals the entire time, knowing that the emergence was going to happen. She was cursed with knowledge from Ereshkigal, and it was really interesting to see how she handled all of that, especially when she decided to let all of the Eternals split up in the flashbacks. The characters make this movie for me because while I still love the story and the themes that it presents, without these characters, the themes wouldn't mean anything. So let's go ahead and talk about the story and themes of Eternals. I won't lie, when it comes to its script, Eternals is a pretty bloated and overly convoluted film, but I do really love the ideas. This film tackles several ideas, and I think it has a ton to say. I love the existential dread that I get from the concept of the emergence, the idea that humanity is nothing but a vehicle to deliver a new celestial, everything is predetermined, there's no stopping it, and it really freaks me out. I also love the ideas of loyalty and faith. Icarus is so blinded by his faith in Ereshkigal that he can't for a second think about anything other than appeasing who he serves. It leads him to kill Ajak, the matriarch of the Eternals, and it drives him to try and kill the rest of the Eternals as well, just so his mission can finally be carried out. And at the end of the day, it's his loyalty that ends up saving Earth, but not in Ereshkigal, in Cersei. He reminisces and realizes that he values the time he spent with her more than the loyalty and role he serves for Ereshkigal, and I think it's a really powerful moment that caps off his character and makes him one of my favorite Eternals. Like I mentioned with Fastos earlier, the film asks a question. It's probably the most important question that the movie asks. Is humanity worth saving? This film explores this through glimpses at humanity's destruction over time. Genocide, mass slaughter, atomic bombs, all of these are horrifying acts committed by mankind. So should they really be saved? The film actually doesn't make too much of an argument for saving humanity, at least on the surface. Aside from the comic relief character of Kurun, Kingo's valet, and Dane, the movie is actually lacking in humans, so how is it possible that they could show the goodness and kindness in humanity? Well, for me, humanity molded each of the Eternals into who they are, and I think most of them are good people. Fastos found new faith in them by having a family, Cersei loves humanity and even became a teacher to help mold them. All of the Eternals are who they are because of how much time they spent with humanity. The movie is able to show the positive impact of humans with very few actual human characters, and I think that's really cool. Seeing this exact moral dilemma arise between Eternals is fascinating because of this, and it forces them to reconcile with everything they've seen. The aforementioned slaughter and genocide raised against the way that humanity has shaped them into who they are today. I also really love the idea of deviants. I've seen people mention that the deviants, especially Crow, never really measured up to Marvel villains, and I think that's because they're not the villain. The villain is Ereshkigal and the idea and concepts of fate and control. The deviants simply act as a mirror to the Eternal, something created by a higher being that is meant to be discarded once it's finished. The fact that Ereshkigal viewed evolution as an issue rather than a part of the design highlights him as the villain for me, and the Eternals are created as the opposite of the deviants. They're all meant to be controllable. And I like how this is handled in the climax. Sure, I will admit the climax does just devolve into superheroes punching each other, but conceptually and thematically, I still feel like it's very strong. Crow has issues, despite how much I praise the deviants above, but his conversation and confrontation with Thena is very well done. Crow is determined to wipe out the Eternals for all the pain and suffering they've caused to his kind, and Thena wants to stop Crow because Crow killed Gilgamesh. The core concept and conflict between these two beings created by Ereshkigal for one purpose is entirely human. Both the Eternals and Deviants have grown into authentic beings with their own agency. This can even be seen again when Icarus remembers the great times he had with Cersei and what humanity meant to her. So yes, I do think this film makes a case for humanity. Now, let's go ahead and talk about some of the technical stuff, which is also really, really great. This film is absolutely gorgeous. Chloe Zhao does such a brilliant job at directing, and the cinematography is often breathtaking. For once, a Marvel film has vibrant colors and interesting shots, and it doesn't just look like bland concrete like so much of the other MCU films do. There are so many moments in Eternals where it looks like, and excuse this diss at other Marvel movies, but it looks like a real film. There are shots and moments that you just don't see in normal Marvel films. films. Sure, you can say that when you compare this to other movies that aren't blockbusters, it's not that great, but I still think it's a really, really gorgeous film, and I just love it. And now, Marvel does typically have fantastic CGI landscapes, so this next part isn't exclusive to Eternals, but it's still a really fantastic part of it. The big info dump halfway through with CGI landscapes and everything just looks really, really cool, and I adore the visuals in it. It's one of the most visually profound moments in the movie, and if there's any part of the film that feels like completely high sci-fi, it's this one. Of course, no superhero film would be complete without the action scenes, and Eternals has several of those, and I do think they're all fantastic. Whether it's the opening scene in Mesopotamia, or the one in the Amazon halfway through the film, or even the climax, I really love them all. They're amazingly choreographed, every character gets a part to play, and the visual representation of everyone's powers is just really exciting. It reminds me of something like Zack Snyder's Justice League, where you just get to see all the characters working together, using their powers and showing off. It's really, really cool. Also, this movie is just funny. Karan is a fantastic comic relief character, and he never feels annoying in his jokes, just pretty earnest and wholesome. It's who he is. All of the jokes don't feel like they exist to cut tension, but rather to add humanity that the Eternals have obtained over their extreme amount of time on the planet, and I really, really loved it. Also, the soundtrack just goes extremely hard. Eternals may have issues, but they're issues that almost make the film more lovable to me. It's a movie interested in raising questions and discussing ideas through its characters, more than it's interested in setting up the next big Marvel film. Sure, we'll see these characters again, but I don't feel like the movie was made just to introduce these characters. Chloe Zhao discussed things that don't usually get discussed in Marvel movies, and I really, really like that. I absolutely give credit to the first Marvel film to actually make me think about it once the credits end, and not just about how awesome it was to see superheroes fight each other. Thank you, Marvel. Thank you, Chloe Zhao, for making this movie, and thank you to everyone who's watched this video and to listen to me ramble about a superhero film. Because, sure, while I think there's topics and discussions and themes here worth talking about, at the end of the day, it is a movie about robots made by space gods to fight alien creatures on Earth. It just happens to be a really interesting one. With the recent growth that I've experienced now that I'm partnered, I've gained access to channel memberships, which are a whole new way that you can support me if you want to. The three tiers I have are $1.99, which gives you custom badges and emojis. Emojis will be coming soon. $6.99, which will give you early access to videos, exclusive content such as scripts and thumbnails, as well as shoutouts in my videos. The last one's very similar to the $6.99 one, and it's $24.99. It enters you into a merch raffle, and while merch currently is not made, this tier is mainly just a broader way of support. I can completely get if you're not interested in it. I just figure I'd have the option. Thank you so much for your continued support, and I hope to make 2022 a fantastic year. If you've already subscribed, thank you, and if you're new here, please go ahead and subscribe and check out other videos. I'm sure there's going to be something else here that you'll like.